Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
It's just, to me, it's not getting us anywhere, especially when everybody's saying the same thing.
But yeah. Well, that's where I come in at, you know what I mean? And I think that's probably one of the reasons why you brought me up here, because my movement, Gritty Style, we consist of the black and brown in Southern California, you know what I'm saying? And we really out here putting it down, and we make sure we watch what we do, because the rap game, we don't have no mentors no more. We don't. The mentors that we do have, they want to play characters that don't belong to them. You know what I mean? And that's why hip-hop is being destroyed. And this is far. I mean, I know the last segment we was talking about shows, but it ain't even about shows. Like I was saying here, we went on break. Now I kind of got an understanding of how I think we should open this section up, because we need to get deep first. It's like a pyramid. You got to start. When you got your structure and you start at the bottom and you got all your right workers and they playing a position, then you could get to the top of the pyramid. Right now, these rappers don't even know what they're talking about. They think that the Molly game, they think that the Coke game, they think that's in style right now, because the Sodom and Gomorrah essence of all these rich people has already brainwashed them through shows. And, you know, all the top rappers right now is really on some whole other shit that people have no idea about. And the kids look up to that shit. They look up to it and they lost. They don't have no direction. It's so many rappers right now, but how many of them have managers? That's why I respect artists. When you say you're an artist and I don't see no manager standing by you, then I kind of look at you a little different. That's why when you got an artist and he's dope, he's going to have a manager. Period, point blank. Really? Somebody has to handle your business for you and let you be an artist and do you, so you can focus on making good music. I listen to people's music. That shit is trash. I can't even fucking listen to an album of that shit. I listen to 12, 15 seconds when that hook come in. I might listen to your first 16, but when that hook come in and you talking about I'm popping Molly's up and you rapping at a beat in the tempo so damn low, and you really think that shit is really winning? You know what I mean? And we got to start. That's why I say the good artists got to start clicking up. We got to start clicking up and start outshining these people at their own game. That's our job right now. That's the new generation, the leaders of the new school. You know what I'm saying? The young generation. We all got to build an arc right now, because we losing, and them negative niggas is winning. You know what I'm saying? All the drug dealers, all y'all, all that fake shit, man, get that shit up out of here. And they don't do it. Oh, no, but it's a facade. You know what I'm saying? It's a facade.
Saying all of that. You know what I mean?
Like, you know, that was that tax. They was balling when that tax money came, but after that, nigga, it was nothing. And then once they start running out of money, they spend a couple $100,000 on buying views, and then they lying to the promoters. Now it get to the promote game. Yeah. That's where it get fucked up. Yeah. That's where the fights happen, and that's why the city and all the different mayors and shit don't want hip-hop in their cities no more. They want that R&B shit because we don't have structure no more. Back when it was real hip-hop, it was organized, and we knew who was coming in, and the rappers actually knew their fans. Because it was hand-to-hand. It's not internet. Right now, it's the internet. Nigga, you is not balling because you got 5,000 followers. You are not balling like that. People don't even feel your vibe.
You do a show, you feel what I'm saying? Showing up, if you're lucky. And they ask you to be a place on a guest list. They ain't paying.
Man, them niggas don't even get out. You got to... There's so many rappers that's lazy, my nigga.
Which, by the way,
you know what I'm saying?
That hits me up to get on a guest list, and you ain't done shit for
nothing.
Me.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. They see you grinding. They see you grinding all month, but 5 days before the show, they want
to
call you.
Hold a drink, kick rocks.
Come on.
Man, the game.
My funniest part is these dudes that are rapping nowadays that try to come up and want to look like they're a big time artist. Yeah. So they think the requisite look is to come off, let me take off my fucking shirt and show up with 20 homeboys behind me that don't do shit but get in the club for free. They're the ones that usually start some shit backstage or something, because they either stealing some shit
or they can't get in. They thought that they can get in VIP, but they couldn't.
Fuck your entourage. You know? I ain't paying to see these bozos. I'm paying to see you.
Half of them be like, no, I paid to get on this label. I should be with him. No, nigga. You got tricked. Yo ass got tricked. Oh, but I'm part of the label. No, nigga, you got tricked. That's what happened.
No, those are your yes men. You know what I'm saying? They're the reasons why you think you can rap.
You promote for them, nigga, and you paid them to promote.
Yeah.
You ain't from that label, nigga. You paid to get on.
For real.
You're a tax write-off rapper. They don't care about you. You know what I'm saying? After they make their money back, nigga, they gonna stop calling you. You ain't getting no more calls. They took that 20, 30, 40 G's from your ass.
It's done.
Yep. Representing a label that's already drowned. But you didn't know.
What you think, Matt, about the content?
I mean, the content is horrible. I come from a big educational background. Most people know I was.
For those that don't know, go ahead. Yeah, let them know.
Which means he's smarter than you.
I was a high school teacher for 7 years in Pasadena, and I got laid off in 2011. And I did whatever I could for bringing in artists. Like when we talk, like I'm in a frat, Phi Beta Sigma. What up? Go mob. But when we bring in a new line, there's a way to bring them in. We call it like bringing them right. And there's a lot of cats that don't bring in artists right.
Like Bo-Town.
Talking about development. There's no development anymore. And cats be looking at TV or they look at the internet and they embody that.
Yeah.
And they don't know nothing about the core of hip hop. They don't know where it came from. They don't know anything about like the forefathers of hip hop, as I would call it.
Yeah.
And they're like 21, 22 years old. So it's like we're in a situation where lack of education gives us the situation we're in.
That's like trying to be in a religion, but don't know, you ain't even read the Bible. Well, you don't know no stories about
it.
You just jumping in because everybody else is representing that religion. You don't know nothing about it.
Don't know nothing about it, and you want to wear a cross. It's
They follow in the style.
Rosaries aren't meant to be
a
charm. Rosaries aren't a charm, you know what I'm saying? Like, cats don't even, whatever, that's another thing. But What I'm noticing that I feel is like the major, major, major problem is the yes man.
It's the guy that goes to a show that's an opener that wears two watches on the same wrist.
Yeah. What you doing, man?
Bozo.
What you doing?
Swag. Swag.
Out.
Get with it, guys. It's swag.
Where are you? You can't tell time on the first one.
But also, I am a strong believer that there is an agenda against minorities to keep them in a place.
Yeah.
I've said this before, and I'll say it again. As a teacher, I've seen it firsthand that, like, the way, especially California, like, we're the sixth biggest economic or so power in the whole entire world, but then our education system, in terms of all of the rest of the country, we're ranked in the last 10.
That's that dummy down theory.
You know what I'm saying?
Mixed with them chemtrails and all the different foods that we eat.
You keep those minorities stupid.
Yeah.
They're going to perpetuate the same stereotypes that our civil rights leaders fought against. You're gonna have cats like Lil Wayne talk about beating the pussy up like Emmett Till and causing a whole entire situation.
And then he's
coming out with a mediocre so-called apology. You've got cats that will ride with it and say, yo, we need a balance in music or whatever, but the balance don't exist in everything that's on. Let me say
that's
story.
That's the next.
Can I go into that?
Yeah.
All right. So I was at Paid Dues, right? Love Paid Dues. Shout out to Billy and Jay Weisberg. Everybody that works there, awesome. Great event. Some things just aren't right. So we're VIP. I'm in this area, and Scarface is doing his meet and greet, autographs all. I've been a big fan of Scarface. My parents are from South America. I'm a first generation American. My parents don't like hip hop at all. When I was a kid, my dad heard one joint from Scarface. If I ever seen a man die, then I seen a man cry. I forgot the name of the song. Seen a man cry.
Yeah.
Never seen a man cry.
Yeah.
He loves that song. Mm-hmm. When my dad heard that on K-Day, because I was back then, or maybe on the beat, like he was like, who is this? It tripped me out because he's not about rap. But the point I'm trying to make is this. Scarface gets into the tent doing his signature. There's two DJs from Power 106 that for whatever reason decided to do some little battle, and one DJ is like trying to teach the other DJ how to scratch. During the time that Scarface is there, I'm thinking like, yo, legendary Scarface, I'm not starstruck, but at the same time, respect. Give Just Doing respect to the legends, you know what I'm saying? Like, period. Mm-hmm. As a DJ, I'm just a dude drinking in the VIP. As a DJ, you would think Scarface is in the tent, you're gonna start playing Scarface music. It didn't happen. So I'm like, oh, let me hit up the DJ. Just like, oh, you know, Scarface is here. Maybe you got some, you know, face mod, whatever it is. Like, drop some songs. Go up to the DJ, tell him what it is.
Courtesy.
He's like, yo, oh, yeah, I got this. You know, I know he's here. Like, kind of like in a condescending way. Like, yo, I got this on me. Like, yeah. Fall back. So I'm like, whatever. He's going to play the song. The whole time Scarface was under the tent,
guess what they were doing? A scratch session. And not only was it a scratch session, because I used to DJ. I got props for DJs. I love DJs. All artists have a DJ on stage with you. But it sucked. It was horrible. How are you going to give a tutorial while this man's under the tent not playing any of his music? Scarface gets off. The homie Nipsey Hussle gets under the tent. And guess what they did? Start playing Nipsey Hussle songs. I went to... Wow. I could not believe it. Yeah, yeah. I'm like, this is exactly what's wrong.
It's Power 106. It's where hip hop lives.
Yeah, thanks. Shout out to Boss One, because you got me this shirt where hip hop died. You know, but like, it just goes to show what we're dealing with. How could you not play one song from the man? And I went to Scarface and was like, yo, man, I think you should, like, be on, like, on the real, should have smacked the shit out of that DJ if you're not playing none of your joints. He's like, man, I already know what it is. I ain't even tripping off of that. That's what this has become. And I was just like, you know, I can't, if he's falling off back off here, I can't make it my issue. But it's like, it just goes to show. And all these interviews that he's been doing, he's really talking about as to what really what's been happening with hip hop. It's watered down. It's not meant for the people that created it. The situation in New York, everybody, I'm going to New York tomorrow night. I'm gonna be there for a week. I've been talking to like people that I know out there, not to drop names, name drop, who cares? But it's like the scene over there.
Drop a name.
Cats. shout out to the Wu fam. There it is. There I'll just say that. But like I'm talking to my homies and they're just like, yo, New York ain't the same. There's cats that are doing it. But if you don't sound like what's on the radio right now, ain't nobody that actually has the wherewithal to put you out there, ain't supporting it. So now you hear everything coming out of New York where it all started, sounding like where it's down south. Nothing wrong with what goes on down south, but that's their thing. Why is that happening in New York? Yeah. It shouldn't be like that. You know what I'm saying? So like, there's so many issues. And I think like with a forum like this, this is beautiful because nobody talks about it. Everybody want to be PC and correct or whatever. I'm doing shows as a pre-sale, pay to play, whatever you want to call it. I'm doing them. But I'm still willing to talk against it because it's not right. And it shouldn't be that way. I shouldn't be the only dope opening act on the bill besides the headliner. It shouldn't be that way. You know what I mean?
As a host, I shouldn't be able to turn a crowd out more than the rappers
do. And he does. For real.
Right.
The fact that I light up the crowd more than these rappers do says a lot about the current state of a lot of MCs that are getting on shows. With the exceptions of yourself and other groups and stuff like that.
Big Lair can rap. Kicked some rhymes for me, and I was just like, "Why did you give it up, man?"
I go way back with Lyric when he was the lead man in a band. So I've seen him on stage rip the crowd.
The band shall remain.
It's still. Hey, you brought up a point though, like where as far as where how Scarface was just kind of just saying like, you know what, whatever. Do you think that? I mean, like Chuck D, man. That guy.
Shout out to Chuck D.
That guy never stops. I don't want to say preach. I don't want to use the word preach, but he expresses his opinion as far as how the industry is, how society is, you know, since KRS, of course. Since day one, you know, And do you feel as though a lot of these artists at that caliber just kind of said, you know what, whatever, man, I'm kind of done throwing in the fight. I'm just here to do what I got to do and get out. Do you think a lot of that's kind of happening? That maybe that has a lot to play with as far as how we're,
I don't think they're ever going to give it up, because when you represent like a revolution, when you represent a culture and you're a forefounder of that, you always going to keep doing what you do. Now, believe me, there is a whole two generations of hip hop that's completely part of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Thank you.
So the negative will never get with the positive at all. So you can't ever expect that to happen, because it's not going to happen. Yeah. Now we have to reach out to those and say, look, we are the one percenters like you guys. All them are part of Sodom and Gomorrah. We can't promote them. Yeah. We can't deal with them. Nothing. We can't do nothing with them. I don't care how much they pop it. That's your fault. That's your fault. Me, I'm not dealing with none of y'all. And I know every rapper in the game. And I'm not doing it. I'd rather hang with a 16-year-old and teach and develop and mold him the right way than hang with any lost rapper right now. Mm-hmm. And that's what we have to do. So I think that it's all timing. It's the art of perfect timing. When you got OGs like that, they're looking for the conscious people with the third eye open that understand about this new world order, that understand about what's going on with North Korea and martial law and population control and trying to dummy down our kids. Yeah, and the chemtrails and all that. We need people who understand that right now, because that is a movement. And once we lose this hip hop, because this is our expression to reach out to all the other souls. That's what we in this for. You know what I mean? There's some people in this shit that want to be worshipped. They want to be famous. Yeah. But there is a 1% like us that don't care about that. We trying to get, when you listen to our music, every song is game. Talking about something deep. We talking about the negative. We don't give a fuck about them. We will compete with them until it's done.
Yeah.
They can't out rap us. You can't out promote me. You can't mash harder online than me. You can't throw a rock farther than me, nigga. You can't freestyle better than me. You can't do shit better than me.
Word.
And that's how we got to start representing on this side.
Yeah.
And they're part of this side.
Yeah.
That's right. You know? And for those that don't know, rappers like Cube and Dub C, I mean, just mentioning Scarface, though, they look up to Scarface, dog. Yeah. Like rappers like Scarface and stuff like that, man. Because I go ahead.
You mentioned Cube, and in talking like paid dudes, I went to Rock the Bells as just a spectator for the very first time, like ever since Rock the Bells was even, like, even when it was in, like, Qtopia and shit. Like
I used to work at Qtopia.
Yeah, yeah. Yo, we had that conversation, though. Yeah, yeah. Crazy. So, like, I've seen before Chang created what he created. Like, you know what I mean? And, you know, again, shout out to him. Man, this guy's getting a lot of props today, isn't he? He does, definitely. And my point was saying that when you mentioned Cube and, you know, how what you're saying, what I loved about Cube, because when Cube was on, Wiz Khalifa was on, okay? I had some friends right there, and they were a little more younger and stuff, you know, and they were like, oh, Wiz is on. We're like, so one of her friends was like, well, I want to go over there and check out Cube. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to go check Cube out, because it's been years since I've seen just Cube just bless the stage.
Yeah.
And her friends were like, but Wiz. And I was like, Jesus, are you fucking serious?
Yeah.
So we actually went over to check out Cube. He came out and he had the latest track that he had going on. It started off, and then Dub C was like, wait a minute, whoa. And then he was like, what? He says, what are we doing? This is Rock the Bells. And he's like, you're right. Fuck that shit. The guy only did nothing past fucking 96. Whole set. And I was like, oh my God, this is fucking dope.
But see, it all goes to this. Like you got to understand the generation gaps too. That is a founding. That's a huge generation gap. So what they need to start doing, and when they do it, don't put them so close together. Learn the game. Like, let it build up. You feel what I'm saying? Let that shit build up. Don't have Wiz over here, Snoop over here, and Cube over here. You fucking, everybody's like, wait, well, I want to go over here, two songs. And then, you know what I'm saying?
But that's the point of the whole show, though, because with as many people go, there are generation gaps. Everyone has a personal preference on what they personally would like to see or hear. It's like, you might like a pink shirt. I will never wear a fucking pink shirt, but you choose to wear this fucking gay
Wacko
shirt.
Wacko does like pink shirts.
You know what I'm saying? But at the same token, I have the freedom of choice. That's why you're like, oh, pink's old school. I'll be like, cool. But that's why you have an event like Pay Dues or Rock the Bells, because you have to throw that on, because in the crowd, there's people that want Cube, and there's people that want, but you can't put all these artists one, so you have to pick and choose. And any of the heads that understand where hip-hop's foundations are will always go check a Cube, because that's a limited amount of runs. You're going to get a chance to see that. I still have chance to see Wiz, but younger markets don't know Cube. They know, are we home yet?
That's you know what I'm saying? It's only in urban music, because it's like, I used to be a drummer. Like, I did everything, right?
I flew the plane. I was the luggage handler. I was a fucking stewardess.
But like, the point I try to make is, like, Lars Ulrich was the drummer that I idolized, because, like, I was in a heavy metal band. I studied that dude. And I'm like,
for those that don't know, Metallica.
Metallica, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Yeah, they record at the same studio I used to record. I record at. Well, plug to 17 Hertz. But the point I'm trying to make is, only in hip-hop do you see the younger generations not caring about the foundation of where it came from.
Thank you.
And that's why we're in
the
problem that we're in. They have no idea. Like, yo, I'd rather see Wiz Khalifa than Ice Cube.
That's bad.
You know what I'm saying? And no offense to Wiz, but you know what? I don't give a care. Take offense to that. But it's like,
but why though? This is my part of the discussion, because I'm going along with conversation, but then I'm hearing certain speech come out, right? And it's like, why? You know what? You may not like Wiz. I don't like Drake.
It's not
for
that I don't
shit,
like.
You know
it.
What I'm saying? I don't like a lot of people, but at the same time, there's obviously a fan base for it. True. So if I was the artist, whether I'm Wiz or I'm Cube or I'm whoever, if I just did me and you were to tell me, dude, keep doing you and
you're going to make a living after this. Do I really care what you think or you think? Do I just keep doing me? And you might not like me. I could be fruity as this Alice.
I think this guy's doing it for the dough.
I think what it is, you know what it is?
If there's a market for it, why should I
this
stop
what you
doing
need.
Me?
Just like he said, he's real though. Yeah. But whoever the program director that Chang hired is the fuck up, because you don't never do nothing like that. Don't put Wiz Khalifa at 10 o'clock and put Ice Cube at 10 o'clock. Put Wiz at 10:30 or make it where, you know what I'm saying, so you can get the culture, because that these shows, these lineups don't come around all the time. You know what I mean? Now you're cheating the whole culture, because he was going to put an essence of hip hop. He was going to rock
the 90s.
Into
somebody that would not have gotten
it. Never not it. But see, now you're like, it's like Hungry Hungry Hippo. You got all these people. You got all these marbles. You putting your shit in. Everybody putting their shit in to try to see who can get more. Nah, I seen that. Matter of fact, I was there when Sugar Free, and then we had somebody over here, and I'm sitting and getting my shoes all dirty and shit like, let me see how they doing this shit. You feel what I'm saying? So I feel that. That was a good. I'm glad you did that. You know what I mean? Because, you know, we got to email Chang and do say that, because that's some real shit right there.
I was at the Bay Dudes event helping out, and they hired me from time to time to work the event. And Sugar Free was supposed to go on the Monster Energy stage or something like that.
Yeah.
And he was supposed to be on, like, now. And there was a line of cars coming in to pay. You know that parking lot takes forever to get into.
Oh, yeah. It's awful.
And you just see one dude just bouncing by himself through the whole crowd at Sugar Free. He was so late. He had to get out the car, and he's sprinting to the stage through the parking lot, running by. I got to get on stage. I was like, that was Sugar.
You did that just right.
You had to get that money, boy, because that was a time
but
check.
But
like
it was
that.
Hot. It was like 100 degrees.
Yeah.
Hey, Sugar Free, man, that dude is really real. I got to kick it at his pad before. I heard a lot of game from the dude is dope, man,
by
for
himself,
real.
No security, yeah. No he was like, I just got to go do my thing.
And he does his thing like a real businessman. So hey, look, man, we're going to get into it. Matter of fact, let's get into that. Whitey got that Young Blue video. This is a little bit what Frank Nitti's talking about, man. He's trying to show a young artist where it is from the roots on up, like you mentioned, the pyramid. But this
is
Young Blue.
It's going back to mentoring, and it's going back to development. You'll never hear no kid on this level. Young Blue, check this out.
Check it out, man.
16 years old.
We'll be right back on the B-Side Show.